Let's continue talking more about line integrals of vector fields and this fundamental theorem for line integrals. By the end of the day, we're going to use a theorem to show that a vector field is conservative. We're going to find potential functions of conservative vector fields, and then we're going to apply this to the specific case of finding the potential energy of a conservative force field. So let's go for it. Now, here is a very powerful theorem, but it comes with a bit of fine print that usually you don't have to worry about. But that fine print is there, and we'll discuss it after we state the theorem. For the vast majority of well-behaved, nice vector fields, the following conditions are all logically equivalent. Now, when you see the term logically equivalent, what this means is that if one of these conditions is true, if even one of them you know to be true, that automatically implies that all of the conditions are true. And if one of these conditions is false, then all of the conditions are false. So all of three of these conditions will have exactly the same sort of coloration. If one of these is true, they're all true. If one of these is false, they're all false. Okay, now here is the first condition. The first condition is that F is conservative. So in other words, that F is equal to the gradient of some other guy, lowercase f. F is conservative. That condition is logically equivalent to F is path independent. The value of a line integral of f doesn't depend at all on what the actual path is doing and where it's traveling. It only matters where the path is at the very start and where the path is at the very end. That's all that matters for this line integral. And the second condition is that if I writing with the notation f equals a function p in the first coordinate, and q in the second coordinate, the next condition that's logically equivalent is that the mixed partials, partial p, partial y, is equal to partial q, partial x. So let's wrap our minds around what this is implying. We said all three of these conditions are logically equivalent if your vector field falls into this most category. So that means that takeaway, if your vector field is nice, if your vector field is nice and you can show that the mixed partials are equal, q dx, then f has a potential function. So if you go looking for one, you're going to find one, which makes line integrals significantly easier to calculate. So if your vector field is nice enough, then we can reverse the theorem that we had at the end of yesterday, and we have a tool not just for showing that a vector field is not conservative, we can also show that the vector field is conservative, which is lovely. All right, the time has come to discuss the fine print, though. So in the jargon, in the mathematical jargon, in order for this theorem to apply, the vector field must be continuous with continuously differentiable component functions, and its domain must be open and simply connected. Now, there's simply not enough time in this course to go into detail about what all these terms mean. If you end up being a mathematics major, and potentially if you end up going into theoretical physics, you will take some classes where they define the terms simply connected, open, and continuously differentiable. Open and simple connectedness are typically described in a class called topology. And this is generally speaking a junior or higher level math class. So we're not going to go into detail about what that means in formal terms. But let's just describe what this means in informal terms. It means that the vector field should not be doing anything too wild. It shouldn't abruptly change behavior and go from pointing to the left all of a sudden to pointing to the right, for example. So something like 1 over x would not count because 1 over x, for example, is not continuous. Now, when we say that the domain should be open and simply connected, just imagine that the domain is just a single region. It's not two blobs, it's just one blob. And the blob is not allowed to have any holes or punctures in it. So if the domain is missing a point, you can no longer use this theorem because the domain is supposed to have no holes and no punctures and no tears. That is one of the requirements in the fine print here. Okay, I suppose I should add, for more specificity, this term is taught in a class called topology. So let's apply this to the following exercise. Let's show that f of xy, given by this vector field, let's show that this is conservative, and let's find the potential function. Now notice that this vector field is nice. This, if we have a look at the component functions are all continuous, and the domain of this function is all of R2. There are no restrictions on the domain of this function at all. So there are certainly no holes or tears or punctures in the domain. And because this vector field is nice and satisfies the conditions in the fine print, we can go through and we can compare the mixed partials. And we can say, what about partial p, partial y? What about the derivative of e to the x plus 2y with respect to y? Well, the x term vanishes, and 2y becomes 2. And we can say, well, what about the mixed partial of the y component with respect to x? dq dx. Well, in this case, the y term vanishes, and 2x becomes 2. Therefore, the mixed partials are equal. So, f is conservative. It's nice, so equal mixed partials imply conservative. So that means that if we go looking for a potential function, odds are pretty good that we're going to find a potential function, because that function is out there, just waiting for us to find it. And to do that, we're going to use the technique of partial integration once again. And we're going to say that p, this x component, e to the x plus 2y, is equal to the partial derivative with respect to x of the potential function lowercase f. Which means that f can be found by partially integrating e to the x plus 2xy with respect to x. Now if I do that, then I get e to the x plus x squared y plus some term that is filled up with numbers and with y's, because the dx derivative and the dx integral treat y's as just numbers. And then doing the same thing, we have for the y coordinate, f sub y is equal to the y component of our vector field, sine y plus 2x. Because of that, f sub y is equal to sine y plus 2x, and I can find f of xy by taking the partial integral with respect to y. Now if I do that, we get f of xy is equal to negative cosine y plus 2x y plus c2 of x, because who knows what x terms are mixed up in here. Let's see. Oh, you know what? I made a typo right here, right? Here I accidentally copied down 2xy in the integrand, but it should just be 2x, right? So I need to erase this, and this is the one that should be 2x. Apologies. Okay, that's essential for us as we play our matching game, because we need to be able to match this 2xy with this 2xy. Those mixed terms match. We need to be able to match this term containing numbers and x's with this term containing numbers and x's. And we need to be able to match this term containing numbers and y's to this term containing numbers and y's. And so if I put it all together, I get a potential function of f of xy equals the function containing y's plus the mixed function plus the part containing only x. And this is a potential function for our vector field. All right. Which means that if we were asked to calculate any line integrals for the vector field, we could make very easy use of this function lowercase f and just plug in the endpoints. And so that is an example of, for sufficiently nice vector fields, a very quick way to check whether or not a potential function exists, so you can go looking for one.